Okay, so now the next speaker is Dr. Spyridon Mavroulis from National Kapodistrian University of Athens, and he will present also on behalf of his colleagues the presentation with the title Multi-Hazard Approach in Managing Earthquake Emergencies Amid the Evolving Biological Hazards, Lessons from the 2020 Samos Eastern Aegean Earthquake Amid the COVID-19 Pandemics. So I will now leave the floor to Dr. Mavroulis. Okay, we can see it. Good.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. I'm Spyridon Mavroulis from the University of Athens. I'm going to present you the multi-hazard approach in managing earthquake emergencies amid evolving biological hazards and the lessons learned from the 2020 Samos earthquake amid the COVID pandemic. This is a collaboration of the Department of Geology and Geoenvironment of the University of Athens with the Earthquake Planning and Protection Organization of Greece and the Department of Macrobiology of the Medical School of the University of Athens. Samos earthquake is the event with the largest magnitude in Greece in general and the Aegean Sea in particular for the last 52 years. The last destructive earthquake happened on 1968 in Agios Estratios Island with moment magnitude 7.1. The Samos earthquake was the largest event in Europe and Turkey in 2020 and the most lethal event worldwide as it resulted in 119 fatalities in total, 117 in Turkey and 2 in Greece from attributed to partial or total building collapse. Moreover, it is the largest earthquake in Greece since the initiation of the COVID-19 pandemic. A few words from the pandemic in Greece. The novel virus knocked the door of Greece on late February 2020. The first national lockdown was imposed on March 23, taking into account the low numbers of the daily cases in the following period. Activities were gradually reopened from the early May to early July of the same year. The second wave of the pandemic started on August 2020, and the second national lockdown was imposed in November after a gradual increase of patients and fatalities. The national lockdown was imposed 6 days after the generation of the Samos earthquake and the subsequent tsunami. And nowadays we are on the middle of the third wave in Greece with the largest numbers of cases, patients and related fatalities from the onset of the pandemic. The emergency response actions after the Samos earthquake occurrence comprise initial notification of the earthquakes, earthquake alerts and announcements, guidelines through 112 emergency communication service, first assessment of the impact and mobilization and response of the state authorities, search and rescue operations, first aid treatment and medical care, psychological support for the affected population, hazard mitigation in the affected area, raising awareness and education for the earthquake effects and protective measures due to the continuous aftershock sequence, provision of essential emergency supplies and emergency shelters, as well as procedures of housing restoration during the post-disaster period and immediate financial relief measures for the affected population. The multi-hazard approach and management of the Samos earthquake and its related phenomena amid the pandemic was a challenge for all involved in the scientific community and the civil protection personnel. This challenge arose from the finding that many emergency response actions required direct communication with the local population, contact and interaction in the disaster-affected area. The observed incompatibility between the emergency response actions and the pandemic mitigation measures made the Samos disaster management look like a puzzle with many pieces, different colors to match and solve. The first contradicting issue in the emergency response phase is related to the first reactions of the local population when earthquake strikes. Residents rush out onto the streets and gather either in assembly points or in open spaces away from the adverse earthquake effects. The gathering and overcrowding at assembly points is incompatible with the COVID pandemic mitigation measures, and there is a direct contradiction between overcrowding and maintenance of physical distancing. As regards the second contradicting issue is related to the mobilization of civil protection staff and setup of operation coordination centers. Civil protection staff should be on time in the earthquake affected area in order to implement the emergency response actions plan. The operation coordination centers in the pre-pandemic era were established indoor sites specially designed for accommodating many people for many hours, and the coordinating meetings take place usually indoors in unaffected buildings with the participation of civil protection staff involved in disaster management. Amid the COVID-19 pandemic, these meetings should be avoided as many people gather indoors for several hours without a break, which constitutes an ideal condition for the transmission of the novel virus through, among participants and then in the affected community. The next contradicting issue is related to the search and rescue operations, which comprise a relocation of rescue teams from different areas with different viral loads and different infection rates, interaction with the affected local population, cooperation of many teams from different affected areas with different viral load and infection rates, and use of many tools and equipment by many members of the rescue teams. All these actions pose a higher risk for transmission, not only in the community, but also among the members of the rescue teams, due to the fact that the movements during the pandemic are restricted and personal hygiene measures, including regular cleaning and disinfections of items, of hands, tools, items, and equipment, must be applied. The next contradicting issue in the emergency response shelters is the provision of temporary accommodation in emergency shelters. In the pre-pandemic era, the gathering of many people in emergency shelters can lead to COVID clusters and outbreaks, which can affect to infectious diseases outbreaks and clusters that can affect not only those accommodating the emergency shelters, but also those contribute to the operation of these facilities. This risk is even higher, greater in overcrowded emergency shelters amid the pandemic, as the coexistence of many people in a place over a long period of time is incompatible with the pandemic mitigation measures. As regards the contribution of volunteers during the emergency response, they contribute in a lot of actions in the emergency phase, and interact with many people and for many hours. Prior to the pandemic, their activity did not pose a risk to public health. Amid the pandemic, the majority of actions conducted by volunteers is incompatible to the preventive measures, comprising maintenance of physical distance, regularly cleaning and disinfecting hands, and avoiding exchanging items and using common equipment. The next issue has to do with the donation of emergency supplies to the affected population. Until now, when a major earthquake struck with considerable impact in an affected area on people, buildings and infrastructures, people from around the country and worldwide are mobilized in order to donate essential emergency supplies to the affected population. This nationwide mobilization in the pre-pandemic period constitutes a strong message of solidarity and hope to the affected population. However, amid the pandemic, the whole process, from the first phase of the collection of emergency supplies to the final step of the distribution to the affected population, involves a risk for the public health due to touching and sharing undisinfected products with unwashed or unsanitized hands. The next contradicting issue is related to the hazard mitigation in the earthquake-affected area. Among others, the most important thing is the measure is the evacuation of the population from severely affected parts of the affected area. This action poses higher risk of spreading the virus in the community, as the interaction with the local population is required, starting from the announcement of the evacuation to residents until they are final transferred to temporary emergency shelters. This process comprises actions that are incompatible with the most pandemic mitigation, with many pandemic mitigation measures. Another one contradicting issue has to do is the, with the psychological support provided to the affected people. It comprises support and counseling sessions provided by mental health professionals from public health services, as well as by volunteers with similar specialized knowledge and expertise. Prior to the pandemic, these activities were carried out in person and indoors with the presence of both mental health professionals and the affected people. Amid the pandemic, these sessions pose a risk of spreading the virus among participants and then in the community. Another issue is the raising awareness and education activities on the earthquake effects and the protective measures. These activities include seminars which take place indoors in educational facilities properly designed to accommodate many people for many hours and with appropriate equipment for displaying educational material. Amid the pandemic, these actions should not be carried out indoors as the physical distance between participants cannot be maintained and they can contribute to further spread of the novel virus among the participants and then in the affected community. In order to effectively deal with both hazards, the geological hazard of the earthquake and the tsunami and the biological hazard of the evolving COVID-19 pandemic, the measures of the emergency response had to be adapted to the new conditions formed by the collision of the Samos earthquake and the emergency and the evolving pandemic. As regards the mobilization of civil protection authorities, the following measures were taken. Two exclusive sites operated by civil protection transported all the required personnel a few hours after the earthquake. All the necessary safety measures were taken during these flights, masks throughout the whole journey, one person sitting in each seat row, hand sanitizers available everywhere. Moreover, application of preventive measures comprising mandatory mask wearing, hand washing, and maintaining physical distances during interaction with local population and authorities. As regards the search and rescue operations, the measures included keep physical distance from the local population when possible, mandatory use of masks not only indoors but also outdoors, frequent use of antiseptics, and disinfection of equipment and tools used by many people. As regards the provision of temporary accommodation in emergency shelters, different types of emergency shelters were used, comprising hotels, tourist facilities, cars, vans, and container-type shelters. More emergency shelters with military-type tents were organized outdoors. Isolation facilities were designated in the emergency shelters in order to isolate suspected COVID cases. As regards the provision of basic necessities and emergency supplies, the modification of food distribution process in the emergency shelters was considered mandatory amid the pandemic. In the pre-pandemic period, food in emergency shelters were served buffet style and self-service, but now meals were packaged and served by staff which wore masks and disposable gloves throughout the preparation and the distribution of the meals and the emergency supplies. Similar modifications were also applied in the provision of emergency supplies from individuals and voluntary teams. Regarding the hazard mitigation and the building inspections, information activities were carried out for participants in civil engineer teams in open or closed spaces with adequate ventilation in the affected Samos. The appropriate physical distances between the participants were maintained. Moreover, building damage documentation centers were set up in open spaces. In these centers, especially during the first hours and days of the emergency, it was impossible to maintain physical distance due to the fact that many residents gathered to report building and property damage. In this case, the use of masks and hand sanitizers was vital. The psychological support amid the pandemic was provided by remote communication via teleconference or video conference. In case of in-person meetings, wearing masks and keeping the appropriate physical distance was mandatory indoors and outdoors. As regards the raising awareness and education activities, they were conducted by the staff of the Earthquake Planning and Protection Organization of Greece for certain population groups. They were held outdoors where the protection measures, including maintenance of physical distance and wearing masks, could be applied. They provided information, including training and guidelines, not only for the protection by the aftershock period, during the aftershock period, but also by from the further transmission of the novel virus. Moreover, the coordination, as regards the coordination of the civil protection authorities, the emergency operation centers were set up outdoors, and all protective measures, including masks, hand sanitizers, and disposable gloves, were applied and available for both the affected people and the civil protection authorities. In addition, food supplies, including bottled water and packaged food, were also immediately available and distributed to those in need, by complying all precautions against COVID-19. After these measures adopted during the emergency response phase in Samos affected area, we present the study on the evolution of the COVID-19 pandemic in the earthquake affected North Aegean region. We based on laboratory confirmed and daily cases, daily recorded COVID-19 cases from the National Public Health Organization of Greece, for the regional unit of for the affected regional units of the North Aegean region. This is Samos, Ikaria, and Chios regional unit. We took into account that the estimated incubation period of the SARS-CoV-2 ranges from 2 to 14 days. The median incubation time is 5 days, and SARS-CoV-2 was detected up to 21 days after onset of symptoms by PCR in infected patients. So we studied the daily cases 1 week before the earthquake and 3 weeks following the earthquake. First, for the Samos regional unit, 7 confirmed cases were reported during the selected pre-earthquake period, while 12 cases were reported after the earthquake period. They could all be attributed to the adverse effects generated by the earthquake. In Ikaria regional unit, only 1 case was reported during the selected pre-earthquake period, while no case was recorded after the selected post-earthquake period. And for Chios regional unit, 86 cases were reported before the earthquake, the week before the earthquake, and 68 cases were recorded during the selected post-earthquake period during the 3 weeks after the following the earthquake. Based on the post-disaster trends and the factors affecting the evolution of the COVID-19 pandemic in the earthquake-affected North Aegean region, it is concluded that the impact of the Samos earthquake on the pandemic evolution was low. This impact is strongly related to the pre-existing low viral load in the disaster-affected regional units, to the measures adopted by the responders to protect themselves and the disaster-affected population during the first hours and days of the emergency response, to measures adopted by the authorities involved in disaster management for the immediate housing of the affected population, and more specifically of homeless people, to the intensity of the studied events and their effects on the local population, on the natural environment and on the built environment, and to the ease of access before the disaster and the accessibility to the affected area after the disaster. In conclusion, there was no burden on the viral load and the infection rate in the affected area, so we consider these measures adopted by the involved authorities as a good practice and an important lesson learned for the management of a natural hazard and related disaster amid an involving biological hazard. These measures can also be adopted in other areas with similar environmental and epidemiological characteristics. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Mavroulis, for your presentation. At the moment, there are no questions in the question and answer section, so I don't know if anyone wants to ask any last minute question, or otherwise, we finish this session.